through my soul.
My soul.
It made my heart in love. Have a little talk with Jesus.
Tell
him all about my troubles. Hear my pain inside. Answer by and by. Feel a little prayer return. Know a little fire to burn. Find a little talk with Jesus. Makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears. My eyes may fill with tears. But Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer. He knows my every care. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
And a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about my trouble. Hear our faith cry. Answer by fire. Feel a little prayer return. Know a little fire to burn. Talk with Jesus makes it right. Have a little talk with Jesus.
Well,
stand on by trouble. And hear our faith cry. We'll answer by fire. Feel a little prayer to turn. You know a little fire to burn. You will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
God, just a little talk with Jesus will make it right. Amen. Inside the gate, inside the gate of home, sweet home. No more to cry, no more to die. A crown of life you've won. You're safe at last. All sorrows past, a mansion here, forevermore. Yes, all of this, I'll hear him say, when I step inside the gate. Inside the gate,
inside the gate,
inside the gate,
inside the gate,
of home.
Inside the gate,
inside the gate,
inside the gate,
of home,
sweet home,
no more to cry,
no more to die,
a crown of life you
Give Jesus the glory. Somebody look at somebody else and tell them, welcome to Cowboy Church. Hallelujah to Jesus. Oh, until we get there, until we get to that gate, there's a highway that leads the way. There's a highway that goes up there. And we're going to get on that highway. Amen? Glory to God. Come on, sister. Take us down that highway.
It's a highway to heaven. None can walk up there but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. Well, it's a highway to heaven. None can walk up there but the pure in heart. You're not walking, start while I'm talking, walking up the King's highway. There'll be a blessing, you'll be possessing, walking up the King's highway. Well, there's a highway to heaven, none can walk up there, but the pure in heart. It's a highway. Walking up the King's highway. My way's getting brighter, my load's getting lighter, walking up the King's highway. There's joy in knowing with Him I'm going, walking up the King's highway. Well, it's a highway to heaven. None can walk up there but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking on the King's highway. Don't have to hurry, you don't have to worry, walking up the King's highway. Christ walks beside me, angels to guide me, walking up the King's highway.
Yes, yes, yes.
Well, it's a highway to heaven. None can walk up there but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. Highway to heaven. None can walk up there but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. I'm walking up the King's highway.
Oh, yes. Thank God. Thank God. Look at somebody, tell them my boat's going to get out of here one of these days. I'm going to be on that ship. Heading heavenward, amen. Glory to God. Well, I'm going to take a trip on that good old gospel ship. I'm going far beyond the sky. And I'm going to shout and sing until the heavens ring, when I'm bidding this world goodbye. Sing it again now. Well, I'm gonna take a trip
going far beyond the sky, yes. And I'm gonna shout and sing until the heavens ring when I bid this world goodbye. I have good news to bring, and that is why I sing, for my joys with you I'm gonna share. I'm gonna take a trip on that good old gospel ship and go sailing through the air. Well, I'm gonna take a trip on that good old gospel ship. I'm going far beyond the sky. Yes, I am. And I'm gonna shout and sing until the heavens ring when I'm bidding this world goodbye. Well, I can hardly wait. I know I'll not be late, for I spend all my time in prayer. When my ship comes in, I'm gonna leave this world of sin. I'll go sailing through the air. Yes, I'm gonna take a trip on that good old gospel ship. I'm going far beyond the sky. Yes, and I'm gonna shout and sing until the heavens ring when I'm bidding this world goodbye. If you're ashamed of me, you have no cause to be, for with Christ I am an heir. Too much fault you find, you're gonna be left behind while I go sailing through. Yeah. Yes, 'cause I'm gonna take a trip on that good old gospel ship. I'm going far beyond the sky. Yes, I am. And I'm gonna shout and sing until the heavens ring when I'm bidding this world goodbye. Well, I'm gonna take a trip on that good old gospel ship. I'm going far beyond the sky, and I'm gonna shout and sing until the heavens ring when I'm bidding this world goodbye. Yes, sing the chorus. Well, I'm gonna take a trip on that good old gospel ship. I'm going far beyond the sky. I'm gonna shout and sing until the heavens ring when I'm bidding this world goodbye. When I'm bidding this world goodbye. When I'm bidding this world goodbye. Goodbye, world. Oh, yes. Glory to God. One of these days, we're going to get on out of here. Amen. Oh, what a beautiful day that will be. What a beautiful day that will be. But until then, we're going to stay here. And we're not just going to hold the fort. We're going to take the mountain. Take the mountains, take the forts. We're not going to circle the wagons. We're going to hold to his hand. Amen. Come on, let's hold to his hand this morning, Brother Randy.
To God's unchanging hand.
Yes.
Hold to his hand. To God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. While you hold to God's unchanging hand.
Oh, sing it like you mean it.
Come on and hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your
God's unchanging hand.
Come on, brother, sing that song.
Come on and hold to His hand.
Yes.
To God's unchanging
hand. Hold to His hand.
Hold to His hand. To God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal.
Oh, yes.
While you hold.
Come on, one more time, brother.
To God's unchanging hand.
Come on, hold to His hand, saints. Hold to His hand.
Come on and hold to His hand.
Yes, yes, yes.
To God's unchanging hand. Hold to His hand. To God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. While you hold to God's unchanging hand.
Yes, yes, yes. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. Look at somebody, tell them, I'm sure glad I came to Cowboy Church this morning. Hallelujah to Jesus. One of these days, you know, back in the 60s, there were several songs written that were played on the gospel networks and stations and on the pop charts also. They blew the tops off on both charts, really. They were written as gospel songs, but they were sung on other charts also on other stations and were tops in the rock charts and stuff like that. This is one of them. It says, one of these days, I'm not going to be here anymore. Amen. So if you want to know where I'm going, pay attention.
I'm going up yonder. ask you?
Anybody ask you?
Where I'm going?
Where I'm going?
Where I'm going?
Soon.
Just go ahead and tell them. Just tell them about it. Yonder. You might as well come on and go with me. Hallelujah to God. I don't want you behind telling somebody where I went. I want you to go with me. Hallelujah to Jesus. You know, Revelation 19, 11 says, then I saw heaven opened and a white horse was standing there. The first and the last rodeo, by the way. I don't know if y'all heard that out there, but I think they heard it in Baton Rouge. Then I saw heaven opened, and a white horse was standing there. The rider was named Faithful and True, for he judges faith fairly and wages a righteous war. His eyes were like flames of fire, and on his head were many crowns. A name was written on him that no one understood except himself. He wore a robe dipped in blood, and his title was the Word of God. John said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Amen. The armies of heaven, dressed in the finest of pure linen white, followed him on white horses. Ooh, the first and the last trail ride. Hallelujah to Jesus. Glory to God. Everybody from Cowboy Church ride with Jesus. Amen. Whether they knew how to ride on earth or not, you're going to be cowboys in heaven. Amen. Come on, Brother Glenn, help us. Help us worship this morning.
He has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand, and he's riding a white horse across this land.
Yes.
And he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me?
Come on, let's ride this morning, saints.
He has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand, and he's riding a white horse across this land. And he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me?
Yes, yes, yes.
Can we say yes, Lord?
Yes, Lord.
We will ride with you.
Come on, let's ride with Jesus. Amen.
And we say yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We will stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. We'll be dressed in white. And we say, yes, Lord. We will ride.
We will ride. Will you ride this morning?
He has a crown on his head. He carries a scepter in his hand. And he's leading the armies across this land. And he's calling out to you and me.
Will you ride?
Will you ride with me?
Will you ride?
And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes.
We will ride. And we say, yes, Lord. We will stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. We'll be dressed in white. And we say, yes, Lord, we will ride.
We will ride.
That fire in his eyes is love for his bride.
Oh, yes.
And he's longing that she be with him right by his side. That fire in his eyes is his burning desire that his bride be with him right by his side. And he's calling out to you and me. Will you ride with me?
Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We will stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. We'll be dressed in white. And we say, yes, Lord,
yes, Lord,
we will ride. Oh, and we say, yes, Lord,
yes,
we will stand up and fight. We will ride with the armies of heaven. We'll be dressed in white. And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We will ride. And we say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We will ride.
Oh, give him praise. Give him praise, saints. Hallelujah to God. Glory to Jesus. He's God. He's God. He made man for fellowship. He wants us to ride with him. A trail ride by yourself isn't much of a trail ride. He wants you and me riding with him. Amen. Hallelujah. So what we're doing here is learning. Learning, ever learning. Learning how to lean on Jesus. Amen. Come on, Brother Carl. Help us lean on Jesus a little this morning.
Learning to lean.
Yes.
Learning to lean. I'm learning to lean. Than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean.
Sing that song, Brother Carl.
Jesus.
Oh, yeah.
Learning to lean. Learning to lean. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus.
teach us to lean on Jesus. Teach us to put our trust in you, to put our faith in you, to put all of the weights of this world in our lives upon your shoulders. But Lord, you said yours are broad enough to carry it. Your yoke is easy and your burden is light. So we give you our burdens because you can carry them. And Lord, some of those burdens include people we pray for on a regular basis around here. A fellow named Ben Flockton, who none of us know, but a young man with an old man's disease, a man with Lou Gehrig's disease, a man with ALS, a man with a young wife, small children, needing a touch from God, needing a touch from God. And Lord, we pray for Clark Romero again today. We lift him up to you in Jesus' name. Came through his heart attack all right, then came down with pneumonia. So Lord, we lift him up to you, Brother Nick's dad. Ask you to touch him. Minister to his wife during this time. Bless his family during this time. In Jesus' name. Brother Curtis, able to be back with us today with a badly broken arm. We're looking to you to take care of it. Those people splinted, bandaged, got it all up in braces this morning. They can do a lot, but only you can heal. They can't make that bone grow back right, but our God can. So, Lord, we just look for a speedy recovery. More importantly than that, a thorough recovery. Bless him at this time, his business, his wife, his family. You be the center of it all, and you get the glory from it all. And we lift up his wife, Sister Lori, to you. You know, she's had some difficulties lately with her health. Still struggling with it. We look to you, God. We look to you as the source of all healing. Luke lost all, God. A little two-year-old with cancer. We lift him up to you and his family. This has got to be a very, very trying time for them. So we lift him up to you for a total healing. Lift his family up to you, God, for you to strengthen them during this time. Brad Bourgeois, needing some healing in his body, God. And Lord, Sheila Bazar, back with us today. We missed her the last several weeks. She's been out having that operation on her neck and her back and then traveling a little bit. God, she's having some infection trying to come back again, I understand. So God, we pray for Sheila. We pray your blessings upon her family during this time. Healing, God, total healing for her body. Total healing for her body. That's our need, Lord. That's our heart's cry. We pray for our nation. We pray for our president, our vice president, safety for them and their families. There's a lot going on in Washington these days. God, we pray for our nation. Things are a bigger mess than they've been in my lifetime. We pray for our nation. Things are more polarized than they've been in my lifetime. Things are more racialized than they've ever been in my lifetime. God, we need Jesus more than we have in a long time. We need revival. Donald Trump can't do it. Congress can't do it. Legislation can't do it. Only revival can do what we need. We need a spirit of revival from coast to coast, from north to south. We need a spirit of revival to sweep through this land, oh God. Catch us up in it. We don't care where it starts. We just want to be part of it. We want to see it sweep through this land, sweep through this community, sweep through this state, sweep through our world, oh God. Oh, bless our people in uniform today, their families, our firemen, first responders, policemen, our military. Keep your hand upon them. Keep them safe in Jesus' name. As we learn to lean on Jesus.
Learn.
learning to lean on Jesus.
Learning to lean. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean.
Hallelujah to God. Thank you, sister. Y'all can be seated. Oh, glory to God. Boy, it's that time of year when it gets cool like this, our sound equipment starts cutting up. We start, the spooks come back. The haunts come back. Like the little boy said, the haints come back. We get this ooh and sound through our sound system every now and then. I don't know if y'all heard it out there, but I did up here. Like the, blew me off the stage, man. God is on the throne. Amen. It's going to be all right. Look at your neighbor. Tell him it's going to be all right. Hallelujah to God. Be sure and read your bulletin. There's things coming up in the next couple of weeks that you want to be part of. And there's sign-up sheets for food for our Christmas supper coming up in a couple of weeks. It doesn't happen at Christmas, folks. It happens in about 2 or 3 weeks. So we have our musical coming up. That night, we have our Christmas supper right afterwards, and we're going to eat what y'all bring. Amen? So, yes. For a minute. Or a half. Okay, you can do it right there. Hold on. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Well, like I say, read your bulletin, see what's going on, because there's things happening that you want to be part of. Amen. Glory to God. Our children's church is going to be a minute going out, a few minutes. Come on, Brother Kearney. Bless us this morning. Y'all say, come on, Brother Kearney.
Hallelujah. Thank you, sir. I love the way the Holy Spirit works. How many of y'all know that when you get to heaven, there's going to be some surprise people? Isn't that right, Sonny? Sonny said, you don't think you'd ever see the day when I would get saved. But God loves each and every one of us. No matter where we've been or what we've done, we got a place to go. Gotta get the spirit up a little bit. I can't wait to get to heaven. Air conditioned, no gas bill. When I walk into heaven with my white robe on, cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. His name is Jesus, y'all. I'll be seeing Jesus at the right hand of the throne. I don't deserve to go there, but I'm thankful that I am. There's a mansion waiting built especially for me. By His saving grace, I'll soon be gone. Woo-ha! Won't that be a happy time when I get home? When I walk into heaven with my white robe on. These old clothes I'm wearing won't go with me when I go. 'Cause I've got something better waiting for me there. I know I will feel just like a millionaire when I put my new boots on. When I walk into heaven with my white robe on. When I walk into heaven with my white robe on. Cleansed by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus. I'll be seeing Jesus at the right hand of the throne. I don't deserve to go there, but I'm thankful that I am. There's a mansion waiting built especially for me and you. By His saving grace, I'll soon be gone. So won't that be a happy time when I get home? When I walk into heaven with my white robe on. What a glorious day that's going to be. Woo! No pain, no crying, no guilt, no nothing. But I know lots of people there, they're gonna be surprised when they see me walking in just right before their eyes. Jesus made it possible for me to come along when I walk into heaven with my white robe on. When I walk into heaven with my white robe on, cleansed by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus, y'all. Well, I'll be seeing Jesus at the right hand of the throne. I don't deserve to go there, but I'm thankful that I am. And there's a mansion waiting built especially for me and you. By his saving grace, I'll soon be gone. So won't that be a happy time when I get home? When I walk into heaven with my white robe on. Said, won't that be a happy time when I get home? When I walk into heaven with my white robe on. Hallelujah. That's going to be a good time, brother.
Get them new boots. Get those new boots and that white robe. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. I hadn't even owned a robe since I was a little bitty fella. I'm waiting for my white one. Amen. I have my white robe and my new boots. Glory to God. Going to be some dancing boots. Be dancing on the streets of glory. Amen. Hallelujah to God. By the way, I want to thank all of y'all. Last month was Pastor's Appreciation Month in the Assemblies of God. And y'all just blessed me. Bunches and bunches with a lot of different things. Just sometimes just a pat on the back and we appreciate you. Other times with cards and different things. It was just good. Appreciate being appreciated. Amen. Don't you appreciate being appreciated? Glory to God. By the way, I want to thank the fellows that came out. I think I mentioned this. Came out and worked on the Ranger cabin the other day, on our Royal Ranger cabin. Got it looking good out there. Not quite finished with it yet, but just about. And it's usable, and so we appreciate all the help that was put into there. There were, I think, seven men out there working on it, and got a lot of good done. Amen? Glory to God. We're going to keep the children in here because someone wanted to hear this next song. Come on, Sister Phyllis and Sister Mitzi.
And Mitzi. Praise God. The name of this song is New Wine, and I just looked it up to see what that term meant, new wine, and it comes from the root word that's assis. It's A-S-I-S. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but assis. And that means to tread upon and to crush. And you know, when you're making new wine, when you're making great wine, you got to crush those grapes to get the sweetness out. And I don't know who's going through some crushing right now and some treading upon right now. But hang on, because God's bringing forth that sweetness, something new. Amen.
In the pressing, you're making new wine. In the soul I now surrender, you're breaking new ground. So I yield to you and to your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine. Jesus, bring me. kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames. You carry a new fire today. For where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom. The kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames. You carry your new but all you have given me, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah to God. I don't know what happened Wednesday. There must have been a bunch of folks got our service confused with an LSU football game or something on our live streaming, because there were over 500 people watched our Wednesday night service. And we usually run around 200 on the Sundays and close to that on Wednesdays, but it was more than double that Wednesday night for some reason. I think maybe they thought Brother PJ was going to sing a special. Hallelujah. Get on out of here, little wranglers. Hold that hand up. Let them see that bracelet. Gracious. Half the church got up and walked out. Glory to God. Thank God for our children's church, Sunday school, nursery. That's our future. That's our future. Hello, Zane. Goodbye, Zane. Hallelujah. Y'all pray for Zane every time you think about him. He needs it. Hallelujah to God. Him and his brother Tyler also. Got both of them, two of them in the family with that. And so we need to pray for them. Amen. Glory to God. Well, it's good to see you this morning. Look at somebody, tell them it's good to see you this morning. Hallelujah to God. I want to talk with you about a subject this morning that we're going to call being fully committed to Jesus. Fully committed to Jesus. Everybody say fully committed to Jesus. Luke 14, we're going to read verses 25, 26, and 27. Reading from the New Living Translation, it goes like this, Luke 14, 25. It says, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Are you sure you want to be fully committed to Jesus? That's requiring a lot. A man that became my son-in-law came to me at the house one day and he says, I want to marry your daughter. I said, you don't want much, do you, fella? He said, yes, sir. I want a lot. I know I want a lot. Say, well, I want to be fully committed to Jesus. Really? Let's talk about that a little bit. Let me share something with you this morning. God is actively seeking people who will be fully committed to Jesus. Fully committed to Jesus. People who are more concerned with pleasing Him than with pleasing the world. More concerned with pleasing him than pleasing this perverted society we live in. More concerned with pleasing him than pleasing their friends or their family or their buddies. Saints of God, it's not easy to be fully committed to Jesus. Anybody who ever told you it was did not know what they were talking about. It's expensive to be fully committed to Jesus. It will cost you much in every aspect of life to be fully committed to Jesus. So without any more intro, let me give you three things that will cost you. It's going to cost you. Say, it's going to cost me. Three things, according to what Jesus just said there, that it's going to cost you to be fully committed to Jesus. Number one, you will worship at any cost. Amen? You will worship at any cost. If you want to be fully committed to Jesus, saints of God, you will worship no matter what it costs you, no matter what the price. Fully committed followers of Jesus Christ worship at any cost. In Luke 14, verse 26, Jesus said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple." Now, this seems very hard and unrealistic, but we need to understand the meaning of the Greek word that is translated here, hate. It's not a hard word as we think of. It's not an all-encompassing word like we think of. It means simply to love less. To love less. Not to detest or to despise or to show malice, but just to love less. Very simple. Jesus must take the preeminence in your life. Now, that's a big word I've been waiting all week to use. I hope I used it right. But he must take the preeminence. No, you must give him the preeminence in your life. You must hand it over to him on a platter and say, "Lord, you be everything to me. You be more important than my family, than my wife, than my kids, than my in-laws, than my grandchildren. You be more important to me than all others. Other people in your life. Other events in your life." I see the license plate every once in a while. It says, "I'd rather be fishing." Honey, fishing's okay. There's nothing wrong with fishing. Fish don't care for it, but the rest of us do. Amen? But unless Jesus is more important to you than fishing or hunting, or LSU ball games, or Saints ball game. Oh, he done quit preaching and started meddling now. Unless he's more important to you than backpacking, camping, anything, skiing, whatever it is. Unless Jesus is most important to you, you're not going to be fully committed to him. You're going to be committed to some of these other things, other events, other things of value, other people in your life. To be fully committed to Jesus means to put Jesus first over everything and everybody in your life. Friends, Jesus will not play second fiddle for anyone. He must be first in your life. Now, a while back, I looked up that term, I don't know, 6 months ago for some reason, to see where that second fiddle came from originally. I'm a historian at heart. I like to, you know, I taught history in high school and college for many years. And I love historical things. So I like to see where things came from that we do. And, of course, second fiddle is pretty obvious, I think. It's not the first fiddle in the choir. Okay, now, the difference between a fiddle and a violin. Y'all know the difference between a fiddle and the violin? How you play it. What is that? What is that? Same instrument. How it's played is the difference. And the term second fiddle came from an orchestra of violinists. You know, to say second violinist doesn't sound as good as second fiddle. To be second chair is to play backup. Backup. Like we sang parts up here, sang some sang soprano, some sang alto, some sang bass. Playing second fiddle is playing the backup part. It's not the preeminent part. It's not the obvious part. It's not the part that everybody goes away saying, ooh, wasn't that beautiful? But honey, if you took it out, it wouldn't be nearly as good, okay? But it's second fiddle. It's not preeminent. And so Jesus wants the preeminence in your life. He will not play backup to your life. You get that? He will not just be there like a jack-in-the-box to jump up and perform for you when you need him. That's not God. He wants to be front chair, first chair. He wants to be it in your life. Can you say amen? My, my, my. To be fully committed to Jesus is to be fully committed to him. Folks, your relationship with Jesus Christ must be two things. Can I give you those two things this morning? It must be a personal relationship. You know, the relationship that I have with Jesus is him and me. Him and me. I love you to death. No, I love you to life. But no matter what you do to me, it's not going to affect my relationship with Jesus. Might affect my relationship with you. Might affect my relationship with other people. But my relationship with Jesus, honey, is not based upon you and how you treat me. Last month was the Pastor's Appreciation Month in the Assemblies of God, and y'all showed your appreciation greatly. But if nobody had done a thing, I would still stand here today and say I love Jesus as much as ever. Because my relationship with Jesus is one of those things that must be for me to be fully committed to him. And I'm not going to stand here today and tell you that I am always, at every moment in my life, fully committed to Jesus. Okay? But I am going to tell you that's my desire. That's my heart's cry. That's my heartbeat. I want to be fully committed to you, Lord. One of those things is that he must be, I must have a personal, you understand, personal relationship with him. I'm building a house out at Scott. I sold our place out of Baton Rouge a ways a while back and bought some acreage out at Scott. We're building a house out there if the weather will ever get still. One of the things I want to do there is build me a prayer garden. I don't want it real big, but I want a little prayer garden with some bushes around it and some things in it. It's also going to be a crematory. Amen? And so this prayer garden will be a place that I can just go and sit and talk with God. I talk with him in my truck. I talk with him on the road. I talk with him at the table. I talk with him at the house. I talk with him in the bed. Talk with him in the shower. But then I'll be able to just go sit out there in my little prayer garden all by myself, talk to Jesus. Personal. See, everybody doesn't need a prayer garden. Everybody probably doesn't want a prayer garden. I want a prayer garden. I've never had a prayer garden. I've wanted a prayer garden, but I've never had a prayer garden. I've had a, that's going to be my closet, amen? I've had a corner of the place I would go pray on quite often. But I want a prayer garden because I want him to be personal in my life. Second thing you need is that he must be the most valued. This relationship must be the most valued relationship you have. The most valued relationship you have. Now listen, your spouse, you ready for this? Your spouse must be number two in your life. Your spouse cannot take the preeminence over Jesus. Love your spouse. Honor your spouse. Provide for your spouse whatever the needs are that your spouse needs from you. But if your spouse is number one, that will put Jesus in some other place. And that won't work. Because he's not going to play second fiddle. Not if you want to be fully committed to Jesus. If your relationship with your spouse is more important than your relationship with Jesus, then that relationship is destined to destruction. Because God loves you enough to let it fall apart because you didn't put him first in it. I've told you before many times, if you need God in your finances in a greater way, put him there. Praise him there. He says he lives in the praises of his people. So if you need God in your marriage, praise him in your marriage. If you need him in your relationship with your kids, if things aren't working out, praise him in your relationship with your kids. If you need him in your business, things aren't working out there, praise him more in your business. If you need him more in your marriage, praise him in your marriage. But don't put your spouse ahead of him. You cannot do that and expect him to bless it. If your relationship with your spouse is more important than your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to have one or the other very long. Because God loves you enough to take care of that. Amen. I love my children with all my heart. But they know that they are not first in my life. When Ashley was a little thing, I called her my bumpkin. She's a little blonde-headed bumpkin, looked about like her little blonde-headed bumpkin does. And I called her my little bumpkin. We were up over at the Grand Canyon one time when she was about two, and this little girl looked just like her, walked up there about her age. She looked at her, and her eyes got big. She walked up to me, and she said, "Look, Daddy, another bumpkin." She's always been my bumpkin. So about once a week, she'll send me a text. Says, "I sure do love my daddy." And that's it. Just, "I sure do love my daddy." And I'll send her back ones. "I sure do love my bumpkin." I don't love her any more than I do my boys. I love her differently because she's my girl. And you just love girls differently than you do boys. If not, there's something wrong. Okay? I love my girl. I love my boys too. I love my kids. But honey, I can't put them before Jesus. They know that Jesus Christ comes first in my life. If not, the last 47 years have been a total fabrication. I know that my children love me. And I know that they love their spouse. They're all happily married right now. They all have children involved in church somewhere right now. St. Louis, Knoxville area. Two of them here with their families. But I also know that they love Jesus more. Love Jesus more than they love any of the rest of us. They know that's part of the cost of being fully committed to Jesus. And my prayer has always been for my kids to be fully committed to Jesus. Listen, folks, nothing thrills me more than knowing that my children and my grandchildren love Jesus more than they do me. I had not taught my children to love Jesus more than anything or anyone else on earth, like I say, my entire ministry would have been a fabrication, would have been a fake. It would be an eternal disaster. Exodus 20:5 says, "I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." Deuteronomy 4:24, "I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." Deuteronomy 5:9, "I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." Deuteronomy 6:15, "The Lord your God in the midst of you is a jealous God." Joshua 24:19, "He is a jealous God." 2 Corinthians 11:2, "I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy." Did you get that? God is a jealous God. He will not have anything before him. God is jealous of his relationship with his church. If you're going to be fully committed to Jesus, he's got to be number one. And there can be no other gods before him. Amen. And a God with a small g is anything or anybody that you love more than Jesus. Folks, your relationship with Jesus Christ must come before your reputation. Anything and anyone who comes between Jesus and me, even if it's me, must be moved out of the way. I mean, Jesus told it pretty clear one time when he said, if your hand gets in your way, chop it off. If your eye gets in your way, pluck it out. I mean, he was serious. Anything that'll keep you out of heaven. He went on, he said, it's better to enter into heaven maimed than to enter into hell with both hands, both feet, both eyes. I mean, that's some potent stuff, but that's fact. Saints of God, what people think of Andy Starks is important. But what people think of Jesus Christ is more important. And the only Bible that many people read is the lives of God's kids. That's why what they think of me is important. But I cannot think much of myself. especially not enough to get in the way between God and me. Their idea of God is often directly affected, directly swayed, directly influenced by their opinion of God's kids. Amen? I ran into one of our church people at Tractor Supply, Harbor Freight, I think it was yesterday. And, you know, we spoke there a minute, but I didn't know he was there until I started around. I saw him standing there on an aisle looking at something. And, you know, if he'd have looked at me and saw me pick up something, stick it in my pocket, and walk off, what would he have thought of his pastor? Could that have affected him? Could that have affected his walk with God even? Man, this fellow's supposed to be my pastor. This fellow's supposed to be my leader. And I just saw him shoplifting. I mean, he picked up that air compressor and put it in his pocket. I went into Harley Davidson one place, was looking around. The fellow says, "Can I help you today?" I said, "No, I'm just doing a little shoplifting, thank you." He laughed. He said, "Buddy, if you could put any of these in your pocket, go ahead." I have done that at Walmart, though, and watched 7 different women watching me over the aisle a few minutes there. They got the word around. You don't tell them at Walmart you're doing a little shoplifting. That doesn't go over real well. But seriously, people judge God by his kids. I mean, have you ever judged parents by their children? Why don't they tell that kid to shut up? They're in Harbor Freight yesterday. There was this one kid just screaming and hollering and carrying on. Daddy right there just totally ignoring it. I wonder what goes on in their house, if that's what goes on in the store. Looking at stuff, screaming, stomping, jumping up and down, little 2 or 3-year-old girl, making all kinds of racket. And I thought, what kind of an idiot is it? See, I judge the parent. That will let their child act like this, grow up like this, thinking the world revolves around them. Honey, people judge God by what they think of you. Many people, the only Bible they'll read is you. Their idea of God is directly affected, swayed, influenced by their opinion of God's kids. My. If their children are polite, courteous, well-behaved, gives me a high estimation of the parents. But if the children are not polite, courteous, well-disciplined, and behaved, gives me a low estimation of the parents. I told y'all, what was it, last week, that I said something about kids a couple of times, and a lady told me, she said, "I have children. I don't have kids. Kids are baby goats." I said, "Yes, ma'am, I obviously know your kids better than you do." But that's how people feel about the Heavenly Father. I did. That was years ago at another church. That's how people feel about our Heavenly Father. We directly influence their opinion of God. We may even influence their relationship with God. To be fully committed to Jesus means to worship at all times, in all places, at all costs. Don't make a fool of yourself somewhere. You can worship within. But remember that you are a testimony to the living God who lives in you. Number 2, if you will be fully committed to Jesus, you will wrestle at any cost. Luke 14, 28 to 32. Jesus said, "Suppose one of you wants to build a tower, or in my case, a house. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, 'This person began to build and wasn't able to finish.' Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace." Now, have you ever noticed that life can be a continual wrestling match? Quite often it's a wrestling match. Quite often it's one match after another, one match after another. Life is work, folks. Life is not easy. Life is a challenge. Every now and then I hear someone say, "He needs to get a life." But friends, you don't get a life. You build a life. A life takes a lifetime to build. I once read the following. A good reputation takes a lifetime to build and a moment to destroy. I'm building a house on my land out at Church Point. Very first thing I did was prayed about it. I tell y'all all the time, pray about it first. Pray about it first. So I prayed about it. Feel like I have what God wants me to do. Second thing I did was to draw the plans I wanted. And I drew the plans I wanted. I've drawn a lot of plans over the years, built a lot of houses. So I drew the plans I wanted. I have a picture that was taken of a house like I wanted to look at when it's finished. But the third thing I did was to figure the cost. Can I do this? Because if not, I need to scale down. Because this is what I want it to look like. This is what I want it to be like. It may just be too big. Do I need to scale it down? Jesus said, if you're considering building something, start by counting the cost. Early on, count the cost. He also said, if you're considering going to war, before you do, count the cost. In both of these, he's saying, before you get in the wrestling match, figure out what this match is going to cost you. It may not be worth it. You may have to sue for peace. You may have to send a delegation and beg off. Life, my friends, is a continual wrestling match. It's a continual building program. It's a continual battleground. We're talking this morning about building a life of commitment to Jesus Christ. Child of God, it's going to cost you something to be fully committed to Jesus. I went out there a while back and hired a fellow to clear out a bunch of the land there. Cleared my 2 acres. Well, I bought 24 acres. And I cleared 2 in the middle front. Gave Ben 11 on one side. Gave Ashley 11 on the other side. Squared up with the other 2 kids, you know, after losing my wife last year. And then I got somebody in there to clear out some of theirs in the back for pasture because that was the deal. I'm going to run my cattle on your pasture. I don't need a whole bunch of it in my name. Just a couple acres in my name will be fine where somebody can sell it in a house someday. But I'm going to run my cattle on your pasture. So we cleared out 6-7 acres in the back to run a few head of cattle on. Now, you know, I did that. And then I started, it used to be a rice field. And so there's levees around it. And I started out on that levee on the front with that front end loader on that new tractor I bought also. Hauling dirt back there, building me a house pad. And then the rains came and the winds blew and everything happened there for a while. And I wound up, you know, several weeks not being able to get to the land at all. And I'm just sitting back waiting on it because I knew it was going to be this way this time of year. I had all figured all this in. Maybe not quite as long in between, but I'd figured it'd taken a while. All of this is part of it. So now I've got my house pad up. And I'm putting dirt around it to kind of level, you know, taper it off some. And work it on other things around there with dirt. And it's costing. It's costing. It costs to drive over there and back every day. You know, it costs to, you know, to buy that tractor with a front end loader for it. You got to figure all those things ahead, folks. That's part of the cost of the land. I bought the land cheap, but boy, it's not going to be cheap when it gets finished. Amen. A lot of things we get into cheap, but they're not cheap by the time we get through with them. Figure the cost. You may decide it's not worth it. You may decide you need to make some adjustments in it. We're talking this morning about being fully committed to Jesus. And you make sure you understand that before you start, you're willing to pay the price. Child of God, it's going to be a battle to be fully committed to Jesus. Make sure you understand that before you start. Make sure you understand. Make sure you are willing to pay the price. Honey, if you really want to be fully committed to Jesus, you need to realize that there will be wrestling in this life. There will be conflict at work. There will be conflict at school. There will be conflict in the community. There will be conflict at home. There may even be conflict in church. Matthew 10:34, Jesus said, "Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword." Friends, people don't really mind if you're a church member. People don't really mind if you go to church once a week or if you give in the offering. All those are normal things for Christians. But when you start going to church twice a week, When you start giving a tenth off the top of your income, when you get serious about your walk with God, when you get serious about the Christian lifestyle, when you get serious about your testimony and your reputation, then you have become fanatical. You have become dangerous. When you become fully committed to Jesus, you have become a threat to them. Your life will make them see that their life is not as it should be. Your fanaticism will make them see that what God wants their lives to be and expects their lives to be is not what is happening. You become a threat to them and to their self-righteousness. Count the cost. Are you willing to pay the price? The attacks may come from unexpected directions. Some folks count the cost and realize that they're just not willing to pay the price. And they go through life just kind of being mediocre Christians. And you can get to heaven that way. You really can. The Bible says believe and confess. Believe in the Lord, believe that God raised Jesus from the dead, and confess Him as Lord of your life, and you will be saved. But honey, you will miss out on a lot of blessings here if that's all you do. If you don't get fully committed to Jesus, you're going to miss out on a lot of blessings. Count the cost. Some folks realize they're just not willing to pay the price. I've had people tell me, God just expects too much of me. I can't do that. If I didn't tell you there would be a wrestling match when you become fully committed to Jesus, I would not be telling you the whole story. I would not be honest with you. Being saved is wonderful, but I did not say it was easy. I've never told you being saved was easy, much less being fully committed to Jesus. Being saved is an awesome thing, but listen, in your relationship with Jesus, His yoke is easy and His burden is light. Amen? But your relationship with the world is different. Honey, it's going to get rough between here and the river. It's a wrestling match to the end. You cannot be neutral. There is no fence. God's looking for people to get in or get out. Jesus said He'd spew you out of His mouth if you weren't hot or cold. See, if you're cold, you know you're cold and you can be fixed. Lukewarm, you're just kind of existing and you get comfortable. Matthew 10:32, Jesus said, "Whoever acknowledges Me before others, I will also acknowledge him before My Father in heaven. But whoever does not acknowledge Me before others, I will not acknowledge him before My Father in heaven." Matthew 12:30, Jesus said, "He that is not with Me is against Me." I'll say it again. There is no fence. Let me give you number three. Not only do you worship at any cost, not only do you wrestle at any cost, but you witness at any cost. Witness, that's your testimony. That's telling others. That's showing others about Jesus. That's a witness on the stand for Jesus. Luke 14:33-34. Jesus said in the same way, "Those of you who do not give up everything you have cannot be My disciples. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again?" Matthew 5:13, Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot." Now listen, salt is a preservative. Over the years, I've tanned the hides of various animals. Tanned the hides of, you thought I was going to say my kids, didn't you? Various animals, goats, whatever. My kids. I've done some of that too. But salt is one of the oldest known preservatives. See, first you skin the animal, then you flesh out the hide. Last, you preserve it. And I've done that in various ways. One way is to boil the hide in a mixture of water in the brains of that animal. That works great. But the most common way is salt. Rubbing salt. Oh, he heard me say something about tanning hides, and he looked at Daddy and got out of here. Glory to God. Salt is a preservative. Salt is also known as a taste enhancer. You know, I do a lot of cooking these days. I get a lot of recipes and adjust them to the way I want them. A lot of the recipes I find on the internet are obviously written by Northerners. Yankees. They don't have nearly enough seasoning in them for us Southern folks. Most everything I cook has a liberal dashing of Tony's seasonings, Adirondacks, applied liberally to it. It also gets a liberal dashing of what I call, it's a mixture that I call Stark's steak seasoning. And another that I call Stark's au gratin seasoning. Because I found that a lot of things besides just potatoes are good au gratin, including grits. Stark's grits seasoning. Stark's potato seasoning. I've got mixtures of those in some of these big cans that I use. But all of these, among other things, have a liberal amount of salt. Tony's, to be exact. I use very little salt. I use a lot of Tony's. Fellas, if your stock is not looking good, if your horses are dragging, if your cattle are not gaining weight, what's the first thing you do? You check the salt blocks. See if you got some salt mineral blocks out there. They need salt. You make sure they're getting enough salt. Salt is healthy for all mammals, and that includes you and me. Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth. Folks, the world needs you. You are a preservative. You make life tasty. You make life healthy. Jesus was saying, believers are to share their faith at any cost. It's not always easy to share your faith. It's not always convenient to share your faith. But it is always right in God's eyes to share your faith. It's always expected to share your faith. It's always blessed of God to share your faith. Listen, folks, people don't need a bunch of Bible quoting and preaching and teaching. They'll go to church for that. They need you to tell them what Jesus has done in your life. They need you to show them what Jesus has done in your life. I'm a paid salesman, but you are a satisfied customer. And that'll beat it every time. You say, well, I don't know what to tell people. I don't know how to lead people to Jesus. Don't. Just tell them how you got led to Jesus. Amen. America needs salt. America needs salty saints. Look at somebody and say, you are a salty saint. Tell them, I am a salty saint. America needs believers who are not ashamed of their beliefs. Who are not confused by their beliefs, who are not apologetic about their beliefs. What America needs, my friends, is more salty saints. Amen. I started to entitle this message, Salty Saints. Believers who are salty saints, believers who are fully committed to Jesus. Well, what about you this morning? Are you one of those? Are you fully committed to Jesus this morning? You can be. If you're willing to worship at any cost. If you're willing to wrestle at any cost. Put up a fight, folks. Put up a fight. If you're willing to witness at any cost. You too can be fully committed to Jesus. Amen? Now listen. I said this a few minutes ago. I'll say it again. The Bible says, if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, and if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. Maybe you're watching over the internet. Maybe you're sitting here in the congregation this morning. Whatever it is, wherever you are, let God speak to you. Let God tell you, honey, I want you to be fully committed to me. Amen. I want you to be fully committed to me. And do what it takes to get fully committed to Jesus. Won't you stand with me? Maybe you're here this morning and Jesus is not Lord of your life. Or Jesus used to be Lord of your life, but you've kind of taken up the reins and going your own way these days. You need to fix it. Only you can fix it. If you believe, if you confess, you will be saved. You need to fix it. Come here, Brother Glenn, our associate pastor. Sister Phyllis, our women's pastor. Won't you just pray with me this morning and say, Lord God, I believe in my heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. And I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. Now the Bible says I'm saved. I'm washed. I'm cleansed. I'm made righteous through his righteousness. I am born again. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Amen. Now, maybe you prayed that prayer. You need to look at somebody beside you or whatever. Tell them, hey, I just got saved. Or maybe you want to come tell one of these folks, two of the most godly people I know. You want to come tell one of them. Maybe you need to pray for something in your life. I want you to reach out your hand. We're going to pray for Sister Julie. I forgot to put her on my list this morning. She's recovering from a broken shoulder. Pray for her this morning, too. Whatever your need is, let's give God a couple of minutes here. The Bible says that God wants us to be a sanctuary unto him. Amen? Come on, Ben, sing the song and let God make you and me a sanctuary this morning.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Pure and holy.
Oh, yes.
Tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare to be a sanctuary.
Sing the song, son. Sing the song.
Lord, prepare me.
Come on, let's make that commitment.
To be a sanctuary.
Be fully committed.
Pure and holy.
Committed to Jesus.
Tried and true. With thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Sing it one more time.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Your right and true with thanksgiving, I'll be a living.
Come on, let's make that commitment.
Sanctuary.
While we sing it one more time.
For you.
Say, Lord, that's me. That's what I want to be.
Lord, prepare me.
Fully committed to Jesus.
To be a sanctuary. Pure and holy. Tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a for you.
God bless you, folks. We'll see you next Sunday.